Sandhills of southern North Carolina. 18 years ago, a racetrack was built just north of Rockingham. The racing here over the years has been fast and competitive, and the tradition continues today as 36 NASCAR late model sportsman drivers compete for 200 miles in the Coca-Cola 200. Number one auto racing network and the National Association of Stock Car Racing present Auto Racing 83. Auto Racing 83 is brought to you by Pennzoil, makers of Penn Motor Oil. Quality in every extra mile. From the North Carolina Motor Speedway near Rockingham, we present the Coca-Cola 200 for NASCAR late model sportsmen. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Bob Jenkins, along with Larry Neuber. In this race today, 36 competitors, seven of them have Grand National experience, so it's going to be a race between those and the guys who regularly compete in the late model sportsman series.
Bob, it always is. And, you know, some might look at this as perhaps David versus Goliath. Some of the established stars, the guys who have run up front not only in Grand National Racing, but this type of racing for quite a number of years, like the front row, for instance, of Dale Earnhardt and Neil Bonnett, against the drivers who more often than not run on the half miles. For some, it's an opportunity perhaps to springboard to Grand National Racing. For others, guys like Jack Ingram, they're at the peak of their career right now.
We have nice weather here today, but this race has been plagued by bad weather. They raced only one time here last year, so there could be some drivers unfamiliar with this one-mile tri-oval.
Yeah, the race was won by David Pearson, whose son Larry starts in the second row. Last year, as a matter of fact, not only did they fight rain, but they actually finished this race in the darkness.
The editor of Stock Car Racing magazine, Dick Bergeron, is covering the pit area for us this afternoon. Dick?
And the exciting Budweiser late model sportsman cars have already fired up here on pit road. These cars look an awful lot like the Winston Cup Grand National cars, but there are some exciting and subtle differences in them. For example, they are allowed the Pontiac roofline, which slopes. They have a little bit smaller spoiler in the back end of it, but because of the sloping roofline, the aerodynamics allow the back of the car to stay down real well. But the real difference is right here under the hood. The engine size is the same. Most of the cars run 358 cubic inch Chevrolet engines. But right in the middle, the carburetor is a small carburetor. A 390 cubic foot per minute carburetor slows the cars down just a little bit, keeps them a tad off the speed of the Grand National cars. We're going to have a great race this afternoon with a fine field of Budweiser late model sportsman cars.
Thank you, Nick. The three of us will be back for the start of the Coca-Cola 200 in just a moment from Rockingham, North Carolina. Stay with us.
Not a week goes by that someone doesn't come up and ask me to sign a can of Pennzoil. I'm always happy to put my name on a Pennzoil can because I believe in what's in it. Engine protection you can trust. That's why people ask for Pennzoil. Now what I'm really waiting for is someone to come up and say, Arnie, I got this tractor I'd like you to sign.
Pennzoil. Quality protection. Ask for it.
Now, Timex brings the power of the computer within reach of more people than ever before.
The Timex Sinclair 1000, a personal computer designed to be easier to use and to own for $99.95. Power to organize, power to learn. And now Timex is offering a $15 rebate off this incredibly low price.
The Timex Sinclair 1000, the power is within your reach.
Howard's folks, meet Bump 32, Route 16. Melvin Foster, Pothole 44, Route 12. Now small car owners meet the Monroe Gasmatic, the first gas-charged American-made shock designed to cushion small car bumps. They ride so good, Monroe will even replace them if they don't give you the best ride ever.
And now in Monroe's Bump Stops Here sweepstakes, you can win up to $10,000 and over 100 other prizes. See your participating retailer for details.
Mr. Post? Need some help?
I'm your Bell System Yellow Pages representative, here to help you.
I'm in the Yellow Pages.
Look at all those trees.
10 acres. We specialize in dwarf fruit trees.
Say that in the Yellow Pages, where 4 out of 5 people let their fingers do the walking.
That is helpful.
Hi.
This is Mrs. Post.
I'm interested in all your fruit trees.
Oh, you must have a big backyard.
Get the Yellow Pages talking.
Dwarf fruit trees.
Let your fingers do the walking.
Back at North Carolina Motor Speedway, where 36 competitors in the NASCAR Late Model Sportsman Division have begun to pull onto this one-mile tri-oval for the Coca-Cola 200. And now we set the starting lineup for today's race. On the front row in car number 15, the Wrangler Pontiac from Mooresville, North Carolina, Dale Earnhardt. Outside, car 75, Neil Bonnet from Hueytown, Alabama. Second row, Larry Pearson, and number 11, Jack Ingram. In row number 3, car number 89, Jeff Bodine, and 00, Sam Ard. In row number 4, Bobby Allison, car 88, Pete Silva in number 1. In row number 5, car number 26, John Utzman, and 28, Phil Parsons. In the 6th row, Tommy Ellis in car 12, and Dale Jarrett in car 32. In the 7th row, Morgan Shepherd in car 52, and Butch Lindley in 01. In the 8th row, car number 23, Davey Allison, and 24, Glenn Jarrett. In the 9th row, car number 6, Tommy Houston, and 95, Bubba Nissen. The 10th row, Larry Hoopaw and Larry and Barry Bostick. In the 11th row, car 29, Satch Worley, and 42, Alan Powell. In the 12th row, car number 34, L.D. Ottinger, and 86, Mike Watts. In the 13th row, car number 25, George Dalton, and 67, Glenn Armstrong. In the 14th row, John Linville and Harry Lee Hill. In the 15th row will be Ronnie Silver and Howard Rose. In row number 16, Chip McLean and J.D. McDuffie. Row number 17 in this afternoon's race consists of Bosco Lowe and Junior Miller. And in the 18th row, David Weiss and 68, Larry Groves. Back down to Dick Bergren in the pit area. Dick?
Well, one of the cars that we're going to be watching in this race is Sam Ard, the white 00 automobile. He's got a different engine in his car than every other car in the field. Specifically, the engine is smaller. The rules allow him, because he has a smaller engine, to run a lighter car. In addition, he's going to get better gas mileage as a result of running the smaller engine, and he should be able to get a little bit further between pit stops. So we're going to keep our eye on Ard.
And the pace car has pulled into the pit area, and the green flag is out, and the Coca-Cola 200 underway from Rockingham. 36 cars begin to string out as the leader, Dale Earnhardt, leads them through turn number 2 and down the backstretch. Right behind Dale Earnhardt is Neil Bonnet in car number 75. They set the cars into the third and fourth turns. The banking here is 25 degrees. The speeds are near 150 miles an hour. Here's the completion of lap number 1. It's Dale Earnhardt leading, followed by Neil Bonnet. Running third is the defending champion of this division, Jack Ingram.
Bob, many observers feel this could turn out to be a survival of the fittest. This racetrack has a reputation for being hard on equipment and hard on drivers. It's a tough racetrack. It is a one-groove track, although you can pass. But it takes a lot of courage and a high degree of skill, and it could be very demanding for these late-model drivers. You have to stay in that racing groove the vast majority of the day.
Once in a while, they apply to this racetrack what is called bear grease. Actually, it's a driveway sealer, much like you put on your driveway at home. And outside of the groove, the racetrack tends to be very slick, and we may see evidence of that later this afternoon. But for right now, a three-car battle down the tri-oval in front of the main grandstand here, as three cars are hooked up in a draft, and yes, indeed, they can draft here on this one-mile track. It's Dale Earnhardt, followed by Neil Bonnet, and then Jack Ingram.
Something to watch for in the corners. Once a car gets out of that groove, it's got on the bottom of the racetrack and gets about one lane up. You see the lane marked by white lines, just like in a highway. If you get to the center lane on that racetrack, usually that means somebody has nosed underneath you or your car is not handling properly, and you may be in trouble if you're attempting to move up.
It's a long race, 200 miles, and so nobody will be really battling for the position early in the race. Those, of course, who started near the back of the field will try to move up. Now we see Neil Bonnet pulling right alongside Dale Earnhardt as they head into turn number 3, and we have a car that's smoking very badly. trying to get a number on that car. It's number 32, driven by Dale Jarrett from Conover, North Carolina, the son of former Grand National champion Ned Jarrett. Dale Jarrett with a very badly smoking car, and he gets the black flag as he comes down in front of the main grandstand and the NASCAR officials. The new leader in this race is Neil Bonnet in car 75. Dale Earnhardt, who had taken the lead, drop of the green flag, now settles back into a draft behind Neil Bonnet. Here they are off of turn number four onto the tri-oval, and six laps have been completed with Neil Bonnet shown as the leader. Jack Ingram continuing to run in third position.
Maybe the most ultimate of all the drafters would have to be Dale Earnhardt. And the last time by passed and through the tri-oval, you saw how close Earnhardt tucked in behind Neil Bonnet. Let's see if he does it again. A lot of drafting going on for a racetrack as we look at Dale Jarrett coming to a stop in the pit area. A lot of drafting going on early for a track that doesn't figure to have that big of a factor involved for drafting.
So Dale Jarrett in car number 32 with some problems here in the early going. That's the Pet Dairy Pontiac. Neil started this race in 12th position, qualifying at 137 miles an hour. But obvious problems with that car. The crew has put the hood down on it. We'll see if Dale can get back out into the competition. Yes, he is. Back out onto the racetrack, Dale Jarrett. Sixth and seventh position battle involves the number 28 car, driven by Phil Parsons, and the 21 of Larry Pearson.
Well, Phil Parsons, of course, the man who's been a regular on this series for quite some time now, the last two or three seasons, very successful. There he is. And that green and white painted number 28, the younger brother of the established Grand National star, Benny Parsons, although Phil beginning to make a name for himself in 1983 in Grand National racing.
And as we go back to the leader, we find that Dale Earnhardt has moved into the lead once again. Neil Bonnet falling back into second position. And Dick Bergeron is covering the pit area for us. Dick. And we have a spin down in the fourth turn. A car has crashed into the inside retaining wall. That is the number 68 car, driven by Lamar Graves. 23-year-old driver has struck the inside retaining wall coming off of the fourth turn, very near the pit entrance. So the yellow comes out, the caution flag being displayed by the NASCAR officials. These cars do race to the yellow, as they do in Grand National competition. Here is a replay of what happened down there in turn four.
Well, Bob, there was no other race car around him. It looks like Lamar simply lost control coming out of this very tricky turn number four. Our spotters indicate to us he actually began to lose a handle on that race car as early as turn number three. And he caromed off the 25-degree banks of turns number three and number four. And finally, the car got completely out from underneath Lamar as he came off the fourth turn and approached the tri-oval.
So all the cars have slowed down now. We see Dale Jarrett moving into the pit area once again behind the car that has crashed down in turn number four. So we have completed 11 laps of this race. Dale Earnhardt is your leader. We'll be back with more of the Coca-Cola 200 in just a moment.
You know there's just one Simonized Super Poly car finish. For beading, for shine, we dare you to compare it to the leading professionally applied poly treatment. Super Poly takes the mud, and takes the heat, and takes the rain, and keeps on beading. Now, how can you top that? Super Poly in a new pump spray. Now you can have that Simonized Super Poly finish in minutes. Super Poly, it's the hard finish made easy.
Buzz for everyone who knows they've got what it takes to get the job.
This buzz for you, for all you do. The king of beers is coming through.
Yeah, just for you. That distinctively clean, crisp taste that says Budweiser.
For all you do.
Hey, this buzz for you.
Most guys spend Sunday taking it easy.
Not me.
When I'm racing the Bennett, there's no taking it easy. So I'm out here early before a race trying to relax.
Just me and my scope.
Just the paint gives me real tobacco pleasure without lighting up. And that wintergreen flavor's a real winner.
Go smokeless with Skoal or Copenhagen. A pinch is all it takes. It takes more than just sun and rain to grow a healthy lawn and garden. So get help with quality yard care supplies from True Value Hardware Stores. Spread grass seed or fertilizer quickly and evenly with True Value's broadcast spreader. And break ground for planting easily with this Servus 5-horsepower chain drive tiller. You'll also find grass cutting less work with this Servus 19-inch rotary mower. Available exclusively at participating True Value Hardware Stores and Home Centers.
Gearing up for another exciting season of auto racing here on ESPN, as we'll have races from NASCAR, CART, USAC, and other circuits. Some of the events you'll see in the coming months: the NASCAR Northwestern Bank 400, the French, Belgium, and Canadian Grand Prix, the Rex Mays 150, and Cleveland 500 for championship auto racing teams. Stay with us all season long for Auto Racing 83 here on ESPN. Here is the wrecked car of Lamar Groves, the number 68, coming in contact with the wall in turn number 4. He actually started to spin in turn number 3, and that disabled vehicle being taken off the track now. The other competitors on the speedway are under caution as the pace car begins to pull out ahead of the first runner in this race, Dale Earnhardt. Pace car now moving off the banking in turn number 4 and pulling off of the racetrack. And so with 18 laps completed, we will go back to green. Here comes the field out of the fourth turn. The faster cars toward the outside of the racetrack. Dale Earnhardt and Neil Bonnett running first and second. Jack Ingram is three. Third running in fourth position is Sam Ard. And fifth is Jeff Bonai.
Earnhardt had opened up a little bit of distance between himself and the second running Bonnett. And Bonnett similarly over the third running and current defending champion of this series, Jack Ingram. They're the first two cars. Earnhardt and Bonnett in the Grand National rank. They've got about 100 yards on the third running Ingram.
Through the trioval once again. And the first two cars now moving, putting a little bit of distance between themselves and Jack Ingram running in third position. Dale Earnhardt and Neil Bonnett battling it out here. Bonnett moves to the inside now on the backstretch as they move into turn number 3. Again, the lead changes and Neil Bonnett moves into first position. Neil Bonnett driving the number 75 car. Neil, of course, from Hueytown, Alabama. He is 39 years of age. He and Earnhardt are going at it tooth and nail here in the early going of the Coca-Cola 200. And now Dale Earnhardt moves back into the lead.
They ran 29 races a year ago in this series as we watched this thrilling tussle between these two top race drivers. Not only can they run on the national speedways, the high bank super speedways, the long tracks, but also the short tracks. They had 29 races last year, as now we see Sam Ard moving up there. Earnhardt won twice. Neil Bonnett did not win once.
And it looks like that Neil Bonnett is falling back. He is now back into fourth position. Earnhardt is the leader. Now Sam Ard has moved into second position. In third place is Jeff Bodine in car number 89, and fourth place belongs to Neil Bonnett. Dale Earnhardt is the leader, but second, third, and fourth positions have changed in the last lap. Sam Ard, who finished second in the point standings last year behind Jack Ingram, is running second now. Dale Earnhardt maintaining the lead as Earnhardt now approaches some slower traffic. Lapping will begin very soon.
The guy on the prowl is Bodine. He's just outside of your picture right now. It's a bright red car. There's Dale Earnhardt in the upper right-hand side of your screen. He's the current leader. Jeff Bodine is really on the move. There he is, that yellow number 89, the yellow numbered red car. Bodine has jumped from sixth to now second as he goes inside of Sam Ard in the last two laps.
Some nice driving here. Here is Sam Ard in number 0, or double 0. He got high in turn number 4, and you can see the car fishtailing. He almost lost it, and that enabled Jeff Bodine to move inside of him. So now it is Sam Ard who is running in third position. Bodine is second. Dale Earnhardt maintaining the lead and has stretched out the advantage to about 15 to 20 car lengths. Well, 24 laps have been completed of 197 that will make up this 200-mile race. There's Sam Ard, the number 00. Sam hails from Asheboro, North Carolina. Started here this afternoon in sixth position. Sam is 44 years of age.
44 years old. He's been racing for about a quarter of a century, about 25 years. We're talking about the guy second in line there on your screen, that white, red number 00, Sam Ard, a man who was the regional Mid-Atlantic champion for these race cars a year ago.
Now Neil Bonnet is sneaking up on the back bumper of that double zero car driven by Art as they go high to pass some of the back markers in this race. Some of those being passed include the number 37 driven by Chip Lane Jr. of Kernersville, North Carolina. Now Neil Bonnet pulls alongside Sam Art as they once again go into turn number one.
Dale Earnhardt seemingly with everything his own way. Bodine had been hung up in traffic. Remember, Jeff Bodine runs second as we look at the third running. Neil Bonnet there in the red and white number 75 and the fourth running Sam Art. Bodine and Bonnet had been hung up in traffic, and I really expected Jeff Bodine to try and move in on Dale Earnhardt, but it hasn't happened. Earnhardt has a comfortable lead at this point.
The sixth and seventh position battle here involving the number 11 driven by Jack Ingram. From Asheville, North Carolina, he is the four-time champion of this division and the defending champion of this division.
Ingram has always driven the brown number 11. He's one of the craggy old veterans, really, of late model sportsman, late model stock car racing. He's the kind of guy who, on the racetrack, as Jeff Bodine comes into the pits, Bob.
So the driver who had moved up into second position and was looking very strong is into the pits for a change of tires on the right side. That is Jeff Bodine, the rookie of the year in 1982 in the Grand National Division. Jeff Bodine from Pleasant Garden, North Carolina, 33 years of age. They're changing rubber on the right side of that car. And we might mention at this point that the pit stops are much slower than they are in Grand National competition. Very good reason for that. They are limited to one air jack, Larry.
Yeah, only one gun, and no matter how many tires you plan on changing, and they do have a rule, about the number of tires you can change on the short track. But no matter how many you choose to change, you just have that one wrench to work with. This is a long and lengthy stop for Bodine, obviously unscheduled coming in as early as he did. Bob, I would speculate that they may have had some type of vibration and they're just changing everything on the car to try and eliminate it. But in a race like this, going less than 200 laps, it's pretty likely that Jeff just ended his chances of victory.
As Bodine pulls back into competition, here is the leader, Dale Earnhardt. In second position now, about a half a straightaway behind, is Neil Bonnet. Sam Art is running in third place. In fourth is Jack Ingram. And in fifth position, the number 28, driven by Phil Parsons. So Dale Earnhardt has now lengthened his lead considerably here, as the battle at this time really is for third, fourth, and fifth position. Jack Ingram in the number 11 and Phil Parsons in car number 28 doing battle.
And right behind them is Bobby Allison, of course, another of the Grand National records. Bobby has not won a late model sportsman race in quite some time. There is Ard, double zero, followed right by Ingram, two guys who have done battle against each other many, many times in the last 2.5 decades. And right behind them, one of the youngsters on this trail, Phil Parsons in the green and white number 28, former rookie of the year in the International Sedan Series.
And running in seventh position, right behind Bobby Allison in that white number 88 car, is Morgan Shepherd in car number 52. Now, Morgan had a problem here yesterday in practice and qualifying. Here is Dick Berggren with a report from the pit area.
Well, the problem with Jeff Bodine's car was a flat left rear tire. However, they didn't know which tire was going
to. And a problem on the backstretch of several cars involved here.
Among our top 10, among our top 5, as a matter of fact.
Well, we have tried to go to Dick Berggren on a couple of occasions here, and each time we have been interrupted by an accident. And among those involved, Sam Ard, whose car rests against the outside retaining wall. Also, Jack Ingram involved in this accident, and Phil Parsons in number 28. So, three of the cars running in the top 10 involved in the incident, right in the middle of the backstretch, and this is how it all happened, Larry.
Well, it looks like one of the back markers spun as that group of cars running third through eighth came through there. And Ard got pinched by somebody else, went to the outside retaining wall. Ingram spins around. Phil Parsons comes up on the scene with nowhere to go. Head on, Jack Ingram, and even Larry Pearson, who was also running in the top 10 in that yellow and white number 21, becomes involved.
34 laps have been completed, and the caution allows Dale Earnhardt, the leader of the race, to come in for a pit stop. They're checking the tires on that car. Apparently, they're okay, and Dale Earnhardt roars back into competition. Earnhardt had built up quite a lead before this caution period. There is the damage sustained by Sam Ard's car as he was involved in that accident on the backstretch. You can see damage to the right front of that car.
Bob, that shades of a broadcast that we had almost a year ago this time back in Richmond when the three leaders of the race were involved in a crash when one of the tail-enders dropped an engine going into turn number one on that half-mile fairground speedway in Richmond. Ard and Ingram and Bodine were the three drivers that were eliminated in that crash. There's Phil Parsons coming in. Remember, Parsons had a meeting, a head-on meeting with Jack. And he also took another calculated risk. He went with a smaller engine block, giving up a little bit on horsepower, but he also got the advantage of a lighter race car, but it doesn't look like it's helped.
Harry Nelson down in the pit area with Dick Bergeron.
Harry, you people are really running strong right now.
Yes, Bobby said the car feels real good. He's just kind of riding around, waiting to make his move.
What will his move be and when will he make it?
Well, he just wants to stay in a comfortable position, and we're shooting for the last lap, of course.
Is Gary Nelson, crew chief for Bobby Allison.
Jeff Bodine, with a problem on the backstretch, came in contact with the outer wall. That car is coming to a halt up against the outside wall right at the end of the backstretch. So we have our sixth caution flag displayed over the speedway of the afternoon. Jeff Bodine, who had run so well in the early going before going into the pits for some tire change, here's what happened in the backstretch.
Bodine getting well up on the fence. He was lapping some slower traffic coming out of turn number two, trying to get around the Kingsport, Tennessee driver Glenn Armstrong in a brown number 67. Bodine, of course, trying to make up those laps that he lost earlier, getting right up on the fence. One of the first things we saw when the car came to a stop, Jeff looked out and put the left hand out the side of the driver's window and waved, saying, "I'm okay, but I'm going to sit her out and ride back on the wrong end of the hook." Jeff Bodine out of it, but he'll be back, I guarantee you that.
Now making his home in Pleasant Garden, North Carolina, a former resident of New York State, Jeff Bodine, last year's Rookie of the Year in the Grand National Division, gets out of the car, runs across the track. Now ESPN and NASCAR present a Track Fact, brought to you by Pepsi-Cola.
Spoiler angle to the rear trunk lid. It takes the field eye, but there is a significant difference. Take, for instance, this spoiler. A little more than 90 degrees between the spoiler's angle and the trunk lid. One of the reasons, the abrupt drop-off of the back window on this car. A lot of turbulence is caused on the back trunk lid of this machine. They need more spoiler for more stability. The other end of the spectrum, this gradually sloped back window. The wind rushes across, and without an extension almost of the rear trunk lid, the effect of this spoiler is missed. The solution, dropped on the spoiler almost 150 degrees to the horizon.
Our coverage of this 200-mile race for late model sportsmen will continue in a moment from North Carolina Motor Speedway.
Now, Timex brings the power of the computer within reach of more people than ever before.
The Timex Sinclair 1000. A personal computer designed to be easier to use and to own. For $99.95, power to organize, power to learn. And now Timex is offering a $15 rebate off this incredibly low price.
The Timex Sinclair 1000. The power is within your reach.
The future of car wax is new Bodyguard by Simonize. A durable wax that's also fast. How? Two kinds of silicones. Low-friction silicones cut drag for fast waxing. And high-durability silicones bond to your car's body to guard against weather, guard against detergents. And the proof is incredible beading. The future of car wax is Bodyguard by Simonize. Liquid paste or express spray.
This Bud's for everyone who's got the heart and courage to go the distance. Yeah, just for you. That distinctively clean, crisp taste that says Budweiser. This Bud's for you. For only $49.49.
Ultra mileage.
Front wheel drive.
Plenty of power.
Five passenger room.
Still only $49.49. I need this car.
You need a Nissan Sentra.
Steal. Nissan, we are
I'm with Jeff Bodine in the pit area. Jeff, what happened in that accident?
Well, I was coming back up to some slow cars, and coming off the second corner, a guy lost it, and I was on the outside of him. He just squeezed me into the wall.
You look all right. What kind of shape's the car in?
No, I'm fine. It hit pretty hard, so I imagine the car's bent pretty good.
You're out for the day.
Right.
And as Jeff Bodine watches from the infield, the green flag comes back out, and we are racing on lap number 127. Dale Earnhardt maintaining the lead with Neil Bonnett running in second position. Running in third place at this time is Bobby Allison. Fourth, the number 01 of Butch Lindley, and fifth, the number 70 of Bosco Lowe. Sixth is L.D. Ottinger. Seventh is Tommy Houston. Eighth is Jack Ingram. Ninth, Bill Parsons. And 10th place, Sam Ard. 68 laps to go.
Six cars are on the lead lap. At the vanguard, of course, is Earnhardt, the guy who is in sixth position, just barely on the lead lap. It seems like every time the leaders get around and get ready to lap him, a caution flag flies. It's Bosco Lowe. But there's Earnhardt in a Wrangler jeans number 15, a car that, in a color combination, that was one of the... and innovators of the paint schemes in NASCAR racing. You didn't see that many two-tone cars really in Grand National Racing until Earnhardt came around a couple of years ago, and they really did bring about some major changes in the look of the race cars and look of the field in general. Earnhardt running the late model sportsman division here this afternoon. Bobby Allison, you see the white car, the number 88, the number that he made famous last year, although the number had some credit before the 1982 season. But Allison running number 88. He runs in second position. He's had a tough race. The car wasn't going all that well early on, but he's really made the most of it in the last 40 or 50 laps.
It's been a race pretty much dominated, though, by Dale Earnhardt, at least to this point. This is the third race of the 1983 season for these late model sportsmen. The first race of the year at Daytona International Speedway this year won by Darrell Waltrip, and the most recent outing at Richmond, Virginia was won by Sam Ard. Dale Earnhardt and Neil Bonnett have traded the lead back and forth nine times this afternoon here at North Carolina Motor Speedway for the lead. And Dale Earnhardt is looking very strong at this point as he leads the other competitors down the backstretch, moving into turn number three. Neil Bonnett running in third position and that number 75 car. Behind second place, Bobby Allison in number 88. Bill Parsons is fourth there in line. Phil, however, is at least one lap down because of some problems earlier in the event.
Well, here's something to ponder. We figure, certainly if the first 120, 130 laps are any indication, there will be additional caution flags. But Bob, interestingly enough, none of the leaders pitted during the last caution flag. I don't think they can go the distance. So if we stay green, we could have some very exciting pit stops. There is Tommy Ellis in the red number 12 getting underneath L.D. Ottinger. Ottinger started deep in the pack. He's been able to stay on the lead lap. Ottinger started on the inside of the 12th row, that 23rd position in that orange and yellow number 34. Ellis, remember, lost several laps early on. He was just out there puttering around, a very uncommon position for Tommy Ellis to be in. Tommy's back up to speed. Ottinger now runs in fifth position, unofficially still on the lead lap. He just got past.
L.D. Ottinger was the champion of this division twice in 1975 and 76. The third red car that is in your screen is the number six car of Tommy Houston.
Bobby Allison has been inching closer or holding his ground or biting his time. Really driving as hard as he can to keep up with Dale Earnhardt. Right now, we don't know. His crew chief, Gary Nelson, as we have a spin in turn number four.
Spin down in turn number four.
Car number 97 involved, Harry Lee Hill out of Lexington, North Carolina, the modified driver who doesn't get on the big tracks all that often in a one-mile racetrack for Gary Nelson, Bobby Allison's crew chief, would have us believe that Bobby's got something left and he's just setting up Dale Earnhardt.
A lap ago, Tommy Houston, number six, got a little loose up there in turn four, and I wondered then if there might be some debris or oil on the track. And just shortly after that, then, Hill did spin and to the inside of the track. The number 26 of John Utzman coming into the pit area. John from Bluff City, Tennessee. That car screeches to a halt, and the pit crew goes to work on it.
Well, our spotters tell us that
of the Coca-Cola 200.
Petty. Be sure to watch ESPN. There'll be more stock car racing on this network than any other network all summer long.
Follow NASCAR's King and the rest of the Grand National Circuit Court with Auto Racing 83 here on ESPN.
Hi, I'm Wesley Phillips for the Tampa Bay Bandits. Won't you join us here on ESPN as we take on the Chicago Blitz Saturday, April the 2nd at 8 o'clock.
Hutchman's car, as you can see, it's well worn out. That's the result of an earlier wreck than the one he just had. Able to go all the way without an additional fuel stop. So he might be able to the checkered flag without stopping again.
Very interesting situation is here because these guys came in for their last stop right about lap 100 as we look at the leaderboard at this point with 57 laps to go. And under normal circumstances, they could not go the distance without an additional fuel stop. But nobody came in, none of the leaders at least, during this most recent caution.
Well, as you look at the leaderboard, Earnhardt Allison followed by Neil Bonnet, Butch Lindley, and Ottinger. All number of cautions they can go. Almost 100 laps. They told us before the race, only 90.
Back to racing we go as the crew is way to Neil Earnhardt and the other drivers still in this race.
But he certainly got out drag race by Earnhardt when the light pole let up and went green. Earnhardt, as you can see, opened up, what do you say, 5, 6, 7 car lengths, and also allowed Phil Parsons to get between himself and Bobby. He's going to want to get up running. If he opens up a 2 or 3 second lead, that more superior speed to Earnhardt. That'd be tough to catch. Earnhardt leads. There's Phil Parsons, at least a lap down, second in line, but in the top 10 in the race, Bobby Allison, second in the race. Right now, going to work on Phil Parsons.
Bobby Allison running in second position. Bobby Allison finished 17th in the Goodies 300 at Daytona International Raceway earlier this year and is in second place right now behind Dale Earnhardt here at the North Carolina Motor Speedway in Rockingham. The car between the leader, Dale Earnhardt, and second place, Bobby Allison.
Now 2 laps off the pace. Here's a guy who won one of the most exciting races on the Sportsman tracks in 1982. He won at Bristol. He also sat on the pole in Charlotte. And I guess you'd have to say, if you've been watching this guy's career, that 1982 may have been his year of greatest improvement. Although, back in 78, in his first year as an international sedan racer, Phil Parsons we're talking about, was the rookie of the year in a 2-year period running in sedan racing, and right now he is the meat in a Bobby Allison Dale Earnhardt sandwich. In a 2-year period, Phil Parsons won 5 races on the International Sedan Series. Allison slipped by as Parsons dropped. Trouble in turn number 2.
We have cars spinning off of turn number 2 and hitting the inside wall, and at least 2 other cars now involved here. The number 61 is involved.
Bob, there is significant damage to the outside retaining wall. I think somebody has hit the wall very hard. There is some debris on the racetrack. Cannot number 2, but someone has hit very hard up there. There is the remaining here. And you can see the debris littering the exit of turn number, the front end or the back end. One end of that car has been ripped completely off. The safety crew is right now checking with the driver. Somebody hitting very hard coming out of turn number 2.
Kind of hard to say whether the car is facing toward the first or the fourth turn. The car involved is Benson, number 95.
He's moving around, Bob.
Yes, he is, as a matter of fact. He's looking into the car. We can see very clearly Bubba has been able to get his helmet off, it appears, and is moving around in that car. But, boy, he did hit very, very hard right off of turn number 2, just as you go straighten out to go down the backstretch, there is a separation between
late model Sportsman Racing. We're going to be delayed for quite some time. You can so broke a couple of railroad ties that support the Armco. They had this problem on Thursday. Rick Baldwin, a young California driver, crashed in practice and it did delay the proceedings.
The preliminary medical report on Bubba Nissen is that he sustained a broken leg and possible other internal injuries. He has been taken to a local hospital for observation. So on 148 laps completed, the red flag came out and the race was officially stopped. NASCAR officials determined that they could not fix the guardrail before darkness set in. The driver...
Dale Earnhardt, congratulations. It's an unusual way to get into victory lane, especially for you.
Well, it is. I'd rather want it, you know, under green, but the way the guardrail's tore up, you know, it's a shame we can't finish. And there just ain't no way to fix it today, so...
Whether there would have been a...
And racing with Neil and Bobby, you know, it was just a pleasure to race with those guys because they raced real clean and, you know, everybody was doing a real good job today.
Dale Earnhardt in victory lane, back up to you, Bob.
So our race summary shows the race stopped after 148 laps. And we only had 2 meters. Dale Earnhardt at caution periods. The average speed of the race just shy of 92 miles an hour. The race took an hour and 36 minutes to run. And winner, and we hope that everything is okay with Bubba Nissen.
Well, Bob, you think about the Nissen accident, it's kind of an opportunity to look at a little bit of the behind-the-scenes personality of the sport. It was a young man who